notice of this meeting of the planning board was sent by email to the Asbury Park Press and the Co-Star, our official newspapers, on December 17, 2021. And by posting a copy of said notice at the municipal complex on the same date.
Thank you very much. Good evening and welcome to the March 21st, 2022 meeting of the planning board of the borough of Belmar. Please join the board in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Yes, yes.
Meyer?
Here.
Almeida?
Yes, ma'am.
Present.
Protem? Bentley? No.
Not here.
McDermott?
Here.
Lindsay?
Here.
West?
Here.
Burke?
No.
Carvelli?
No.
Fierro?
No.
And we have Mike de Blasio?
Here.
Here.
Good, thank you very much. Doug, I don't know if there's anything on the workshop topic. I know we have an ordinance that we're gonna walk through, but.
It's just the ordinance. Really all you have this evening is your usual business approval of the minutes, approval of the resolution. It was memorialization of the resolution, and we'll go through the ordinance, so we really don't have a workshop.
Okay, thank you. All right, given that, can I have a motion to waive the reading and approve the minutes from the February 14, 2022 planning board meeting?
I'll offer.
Thank you, Rick. Can I get a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. West. And then you roll down the line and ask everyone to throw
this.
Kathleen West?
Yes.
Mike de Blasio?
Yes.
Jay McDermott?
Yes.
Luis Fierro is not here. Bill Lindsay?
Yes.
Rick Meyer?
Yes.
Tony Almeida?
Yes.
That's a good job.
Thank you very much. Can I have a motion to waive the reading and approve the resolution approving the application of Valerio Properties LLC at 303 10th Avenue?
I'll offer.
Thank you, Mr. Myers.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Blasio. Roll call one more time, please.
Kathleen West?
Yes.
Mike de Blasio?
Yes.
Jay McDermott?
Yes.
Bill Lindsay?
Yes.
Rick Meyer?
Yes.
Tony Almeida?
Yes.
All right, next on the agenda is the review of Ordinance 2022-09, amending the Flood Damage Prevention Ordinance.
Some of you have been here for one of the year, staring at me and saying, Mr. Kovacs, didn't we just do this on June 21st, 2021? And my answer to you is yes, we did. However, there's some minor modifications to this ordinance. So we're going to review that. As I usually say in my preliminary remarks, the planning board, one of its roles, in addition to hearing applications, is to review ordinances that impact development, development regulations in the borough of Belmar. In this instance, what we're doing is reviewing the ordinance which will amend chapter 35, which is this instance dealing with our floodplain maintenance. We're going to repeal that, we're going to replace it with this ordinance. The ordinance adopts flood hazard maps. It designates a floodplain administrator. It takes care of a couple of other details that essentially bring our ordinances into conformance with the FEMA regulations and also the national insurance agencies which support and help people when they have problems with flood. New Jersey found that it was a little bit out of step with some of those regulations in order to bring them in line to make sure that number one, we have adequate mapping, we have adequate designations for insurance maps, which then gives us, if you will, a better or more reasonable insurance rate and then provides for insurance for our community when, if and when there is damage. It is recommended by the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection that we adopt this ordinance. The reason you do that is because it sets certain standards, you know, when and if you can get variances for building in flood-prone areas. Who makes the determination and the recommendation? The designation of the floodplain administrator in this instance is our consulting engineer. I don't want to go through or get into the reads too much of what this ordinance does, but I do want to highlight a couple of things. It designates your zones, it adopts the appropriate mapping, it gives the duties and the powers to the floodplain administrator, again, that's our borough engineer, what they're supposed to be doing when they review ordinances, what they're supposed to be doing when they review applications. You're going to see that, unlike certain variances that the planning board hears, if there's going to be a variance for a floodplain regulation, it's going to be treated along the lines as what I would characterize as a D variance. So that the planning board would not be hearing that. It's going to be heard by the zoning board of adjustment. And just to briefly direct your attention to those standards, if you take a look at page 16, this is section 35-7.6, you're going to hear some familiarity, conditions for the issuance of variances. Variances shall only be issued upon submission by the applicant of a showing of good and sufficient cause that the characteristics of the size, configuration of topography of the site, limit compliance with any provisions of these regulations or renders the elevation standards of the building code inappropriate. B, the determination that failure to grant the variance would result in exceptional hardship to the physical characteristics, due to the physical characteristics of the land that render the lot undevelopable. You need to hear some of that language that we're used to with regard to hardship variance. This is the D variance. It's going to be heard by the zoning board of adjustment. Again, a determination that the granting of a variance will not result in increased flood heights, additional threats to public safety, extraordinary public expense, or create nuisances, cause fraud on or victimization of the public, or conflict with existing local laws or ordinances. The determination that the variance is the minimum necessary considering the flood hazard to afford relief. You're hearing some of those languages that we usually talk about when we're granting variance. What's the positive criteria? You can grant it without detriment. What's the negative criteria? That it's limited to these specific conditions applicable to a specific type of property or topography. So some of the standards, it's not reinvention. It's just a recharacterization of the focus, if you will, is the impact on our floodplain or flood-prone areas. As I said, we recently looked at some of these things. As of a year ago, there are some minor tweaks to make sure that the maps are accurate and we're adapting those. It's really those things that are outside of this by way of the maps and some of the insurance regulations where we're adopting it by language that have changed. There's really not a substantive change to our ordinance, but it's recommended by the New Jersey Environmental Protection that we re-adopt to make sure that we're up to speed. If you want to take a look at page 28, again, some of the other things where it gets more into our bailiwick, subdivisions and other developments, you're going to see some standards there. The proposals are consistent with the need to minimize flood damage. All public utilities and facilities such as sewer, gas, electric, water systems are located and constructed to minimize or eliminate flood damage. Adequate drainage. So these are some of the things that we would normally take a look at. So we're going to be seeing probably more in our examination when we have a review, maybe not so much on individual property, but on properties that are of greater dimension, properties that are in flood areas or designated flood areas or flood-prone areas. You're going to be seeing a little more attention being given by our consulting engineer, I would suspect, just as we've seen over time when we had our other drainage and stormwater management, we've seen additional sections of those reviews addressing specifically stormwater management, you're going to start seeing sections with regard to flood-prone areas and these types of things. And the reason the standards are somewhat exacting for the variance is because what's happening with this coordination of flood prone areas, insurance companies providing insurance for these areas, and some of these are federally backed or supported programs, obviously FEMA is. But what they're trying to do is say, if we're going to do this, if we're going to be helping you with insurance and provide reasonable insurance rates, if we're going to pay for damage for flood areas, we're going to want you to have ordinances in place that are somewhat exacting as to when and if you can grant a variance. Because at a sort of at a macro level, it makes no sense to constantly repeat the mistakes of the past and expect an insurance company to continue to fund those things without any changes. So sort of a quid pro quo is, we're going to give you some reasonable rates, but we want to make sure that your data is up to date, that where you have a floodplain or where you have a flood-prone area, we're going to require certain standards when you build there, if we're going to allow you to build there. And if you are allowed to do that and you meet a variance from the standard, you're going to have to meet the higher standards of what I would say are akin to a D variance rather than the bulk or the salt C. So there really isn't much change for those of you who have been around for more than a year. For those who have not, this is basically an ordinance formulation. I'm giving you the soft sell right now. Our consulting engineer basically says, you gotta do it. This isn't something that's negotiable, quite frankly, if you want to have reasonable insurance rates. If you don't have this, you're leaving your community unprotected. So by having these things in place, at least you're giving the first round of protection. Then it's a matter of making sure that you're complying, not granting variances, what I characterize as willy-nilly, and that you're doing what you need to do to make sure that you're conforming with New Jersey regulations adopted by or backed by federal statutes and federal programs. Normally what I would do, if we had our consulting engineer here, I would ask if there were anything that they saw within this ordinance that was at odds with or inconsistent with our master plan and development regulations. We don't have a person to render that opinion this evening. I will tell you, though, that they have given an email to April Claudio to that effect. I'd like to make that part of the record. I'll probably have that marked as an exhibit so that that's there.
Yes.
Basically, from Kristen Bell saying that these are consistent with some of the changes we recently did a year ago, but this is a minor tweaking. A year ago, she rendered that opinion that these ordinances were consistent with the development regulations in the master plan for our borough, and I would ask you to adopt that same finding as we made a few time ago.
Okay, any questions from the board? Comments, questions? Nothing?
I have one. Yeah, and part of that, I left my revised my notes that I had on this at home. But one that I was just curious with, I deal with is the final map is dictated by FEMA.
Correct.
So, you know, insurance carriers sometimes have a tendency to not use the FEMA maps, but they're pulling data from other sources. But it's safe to say that FEMA's website is going to dictate flood zones and flood elevations.
And I think that's what we're doing right now, that FEMA has sort of slightly tweaked from a year ago what they had before, and we're adopting those as the base.
That's my understanding from this whole thing. And how often do we think that they'll continually keep?
How often?
I only ask because
after Irene, I would have told you now.
Yeah.
After Sandy, I would have told you now. Mm-hmm. Then 21 happened. Still some changes, and I'm hearing, less than a year, we're changing again, and I think it's primarily because of the maps. So I think it's going to be continuing to change. I'm hoping it won't be this cumbersome. I hope in the future we won't be having to, because I would suggest to you that 98% of the wording here is unchanged from what we did a year ago, but there are changes in the maps. I'm hoping that in the future, we can just shorthand and adopt the maps.
You beat me to my next.
That was my question, was the maps.
You beat me to my next question.
Okay, I mean, just, you're asking to predict the future with this in light of what we're hearing with global warming, with what we're hearing with rising tide levels, with what we're hearing about how we're defining what is a floodplain or a flood-prone area. I wish I had that knowledge.
I should have been more direct in my question, because I certainly left it vague.
It'd be nice to see the maps.
It would be nice to see.
It'd be nice to see the maps. We're all familiar with the town.
They are, I mean, you can push your FEMA maps on your website to grab those.
There you go.
They're incorporated by reference here, but they are readily available.
So it's not something the town's publishing, it's just really adopting what's out there already with FEMA.
That's true.
It's, in a sense, it's kind of like when we adopt the construction code, if you will. This is the construction code for flood plains and flood prone areas. Rather than reinventing a construction code, we adopt that as our code, something that's uniform throughout the state, again, based upon the recommendations. Sort of like residential site improvement standards, we adopt those based upon a standard that's recommended. In this instance, it would be helpful, but they are available for you to review.
And we know our town. I would just be interested to see if there's any surprises that an area that I might think is applicable, as a flood zone, maybe it isn't.
And that would be something that I would feel more comfortable having our consulting engineer tell you, someone who's really charged with that responsibility. Unfortunately, schedules being what they were, they could not make it this evening.
We did attempt to get them here, but we couldn't get them.
Yeah, I can read the words, but I can't necessarily interpret what the FEMA maps say or why there's a dividing line between here and there. I don't have that knowledge.
I'm not even sure they could respond to that, because it's all coming down from FEMA. So they're just interpreting what they get. They're not necessarily able to add any definition to boundaries.
Okay.
I'm sure that's the case.
Okay, these are my questions. But I'm not going to bore you, but these are the tabs for my questions. If we had the consulting engineer, I will still raise those with our consulting engineer.
Okay.
But I'm satisfied as to the sufficiency of the ordinance.
So this is a review. We're not necessarily voting on it. We're offering comment.
No. This is a review. And again, I know we had some dispute on this. I don't have a problem if you open up to public to have any questions or concerns or any expressions made by the public, as we've done in the past, where this goes at the end for those who are joining us of more recent vintage. We will prepare. I will take comments back to mayor and council, whatever our concerns were. Largely, it's probably going to track the report that we did last time as to what the basis of this ordinance is, what the background of this ordinance is, and then our ultimate conclusion, which is whether or not it is in conflict with the development regulations or master plan. And if there were comments by members of the public, again, we don't draft the ordinance, we don't approve of the ordinance, we don't vote on the ordinance. We simply act as the borough's legislative committee to say, okay, in our view, it's consistent or it isn't consistent. If it isn't consistent, we identify where the inconsistencies are. And if there were other comments made, share those with mayor and council, quote unquote, for what it's worth, because we usually handle it in a very transparent way here.
Any questions? Let's open it to the public, and then I certainly would encourage Doug to write the letter. You have your questions.
Yeah.
I'll ask the board of their thoughts as to whether it's consistent with the master plan or not in a moment. I think we should include comments, questions like Tony's, and I think it's a blended view of your comment that we certainly would encourage that this ordinance change be set up in such a way that any future map additions or edits could be folded in without having to rewrite the ordinance. And I know there's no way of guaranteeing that, depending on the extent of the changes, but certainly if there's an effort that can be put to make that a simpler edit down the road, it would certainly be beneficial, I think.
Or at least give us the highlighted version from what you changed.
Yeah.
This time.
So we're not looking around for Waldo everywhere we go, right?
As opposed to going through
As, I also agree with Bill that it wouldn't have been a bad thing to include the maps, because, you know, not everyone wants to go out and play, let's find FEMA, because it's not the easiest site to navigate.
Well, I was going to go there, and I opted not to, but I think it's important, I think it should be addressed in the ordinance.
Yeah.
I think it should be, you know.
I think there's a reference there, but it still doesn't make it any easier.
It doesn't dictate, is it www.fema?
Somebody, if you don't want somebody going, oh, I didn't know that was a flood zone, you know, the more public knowledge of what a flood zone is, they don't have problems.
Yeah, I don't think it would have been a bad.
We're a town with three walk water on three sides that are tidal and lakes.
It is on the website.
We expect that.
I would suggest that there is sort of sometimes a disconnect, but we've experienced that disconnect simply in areas where does CAFRA's jurisdiction begin and end? In a sense, when someone makes a development application, we advise them of those things. We tell them that, you know, where they're going to need approvals and that type, and to the extent that they are in a floodplain, that's going to be part and parcel of the information. Or at least a checkoff on our, I know the board has seen in the past, we have sort of our packet when you put a development application in, where we specifically ask, have you confirmed whether or not this is a CAFRA, is it not CAFRA? And your professionals hopefully will be able to highlight for that for you if you proceed per se. When the application comes in for review, you will highlight there any improvements that you need to have drawn from you.
Yeah, so it may be in a revision to develop an application in order to close to keep that in there. Just a point, Kathleen did find the FEMA map or the reference map on our website, on the Belmar website.
It's on the Belmar website. And we're following the most restrictive, correct? Is that what the ordinance is saying?
I believe so. I believe that's the interpretation that I'm giving.
It's a 500 year?
Yeah, 500. Well, the most restrictive, I guess.
Is it 5 or 100? Did you ask? That's got to be one of your questions.
Well, that was a question I had, because I thought it said 500.
Yeah, because typically it's 100 year. Because what's on the website is 500.
Oh, is that what those?
No, that's what you're saying.
Well, I thought it was on here that they talked about 500 year restricted.
They referenced the 500 year flood elevation, elevation of flooding having a 0.2% annual chance of being equal or exceeded in a given year. And I think that's the reason we have that definition is because that's what's being applied. I'm referring to our definitions in section 35-9.
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily say, this is Kavakian's plan, but it doesn't necessarily say if it's 500 a year or not. It's out on the website. I think that's the question. It does note, to Kathleen's comment, most restrictive PFE, but not really sure if it's listing 500 or not. It may be helpful to include that if that's what
we're referring to. I don't know that we get, I don't know that
we don't get to edit. Choose. What's that?
I don't know that we get to pick and choose.
Well, he's got his title block on this drawing, so you can put your title block on, you can add any title you want on the thing, because it does have the borough of Belmar and everything, it's not just FEMA's map. All right, I'll open it up to the public for comment. If you'd like to make a comment regarding this ordinance number 2022-09, please step forward, state your name, spell it, and provide your street address. Seeing no one, I'll close the public portion on this ordinance. And I'll ask the board if you have any other questions. If not, I'll ask for an opinion.
I do want to point one more out. Yes, Mr. Chairman. So in the habitable building section, just briefly, they're referencing the design flood elevation, which is obviously there's the BFE, your base flood, your AE zone or V zone. And then everything they're referencing is that the building has to be at or above the design flood. But it's not referencing what that is to the base flood, whether it's 1 foot above BFE, 2 foot above BFE. And in some towns, we've had to go a foot above your DFE. They're not referencing any of that in here.
are a foot above, by the way.
Foot above BFE or the design?
Above BFE.
That's what most times are, the design foot. Well, that's the foot code, so I'll call it.
Right. But it's certainly.
The design foot does vary within.
Other bounds, yeah.
Does it back it in with our definition?
There is no definition of design foot on your.
No, I'm saying, does it back it in what we regard to free? Freeboard? No, it doesn't. I'm looking at the back way.
Oh.
But it doesn't seem to do it any better there. A factor of safety usually expressed in feet above flood level for purposes of floodplain management, freeboard.
And I think it's worth adding the definition too, for sure.
Oh, yeah, there, so when I went to reference CFD to find that, it was not there, so.
And.
I think it would be pretty important to say, okay, your DFE, your design flood, is 1 foot above your BFE, and that's what we're referencing.
Especially if you reference it in the ordinance, we should have a definition.
Everything they say about the height of structures is referencing your design flood elevation. So that should definitely be defined in height.
It's a good catch. What page are you looking at?
Right, now, if you look at 3515.2.
Page number?
31. So just, for example, all new construction substantial improvements for non-residential structures shall be in accordance with ASC Chapter 7, but be elevated to or above the local design flood elevation as determined in 3523. Okay, so we can put that and double check. Yeah, good. Just that in the front. Always set to the local design flood.
It gets close, but it's not refined.
No, it talks about multiple sources now.
Right.
Yes, I'm trying to find something through the elevation certificate, but it again doesn't give us.
Unless you have, once you fill, you have to get an elevation certificate saying that you are above your DFE, but what is it as compared to your BFE?
Well, that's.
Again, sometimes you have to be 2 feet above your BFE.
Yeah.
They adopted that in their ordinances, so, Manasquan's one of them, a few others.
There's a note here in 35.3.7, design flood elevations are not specified, the floodplain administrator is authorized to require the applicant to, and then it lists. Fast forward, the accuracy of the data submitted for each determination shall be the responsibility of the applicant.
And that was 35.7?
Page 8, 35.3.7. And it also references you back to 35.2 and 35.3.
Maybe there are some people in zone X that are not, the infamous X that's a flood zone but not a flood zone.
Still requires flood insurance.
Right.
So on the next, my two neighbors on both sides of me are eight. How's that possible? I mean, I'm happy.
I mean, it's sending us all over the place, different sections, but I don't see a clear definition.
But that's a comment in and of itself.
So make it a
definition. Should be clear as to what?
Yeah. Because it's kicking us back and forth.
I think that would help, as people look into what they can or can't do with their homes, it would certainly give someone like a resident without having an engine say, okay, this is where I can start, and it's more of like a layman's term.
Oh, yeah, and that may be something that, because we have seen that. We have seen that where, actually before Sandy, my recollection was someone where they had, after Irene, they sought a height variance, but because what they were doing was that they were going to put their utilities above your bay, but they wanted to go sort of 2.5 feet, and they wanted to be able to put that into their elevation all the way up. And they were basically using that as a basis to say, I want a height variance instead of going to 35 feet. I'm only going to have 2.5 stories. But my building area is 35 feet, but I'm going to ask for 38.5, which is, you know, that triggering point for what you can get before you get into a higher variance. And that's my basis for hardship, because I don't have a location where I can really put in a basement to put in my utilities. But if I can go an extra foot higher and you give me that height between what I put up in the attic, if you will, and what I put underneath, I'll be able to conform to what everybody wants, and in this area, you're not going to notice the difference of like the 3.5 feet. And again, my recollection is, because they were in a block where it was 2.5 stories, 35 feet, as opposed to some of those areas where we have one-story little bungalows, it wasn't a big stretch. And it was, to my way of thinking, a creative way to present your request for a variance, because it really wasn't creating more habitable space for you to use to put more people in. It was really just to make sure that you weren't going to be having a problem with floods. So I can see where it's necessary to do that. And I think when we originally were trying to design some of our ordinances in the short term, we were looking at things like that. And I think we came up with a number at that time. That may now have been revised as a result of these. So I think it's a good point to raise with Mayor and Council and say that should be very clear as to what we want by way of instead of giving me a verbal definition, can you give me some inches?
Right.
Can you give me some, you know?
Or you don't want to have it fall in the administrator's hands to have to define that on a case by case basis. It should be universal.
I think most of our administrators are, you know, have the best of intentions, but you know, perhaps in the future when it's another consulting engineer and we have some degree of subjective determination, we'd like to make sure that people's expectations of what's happened in the past is what's going to happen in the future. We'll go forward. So I think it's a good point to raise.
Any other questions or comments? All right, seeing none, I'll ask.
If I can, just to make sure I have it. We would like to, in the future, to encourage that any ordinance revisions, where it's just simply going to be maps that we're not redoing and revamping everything. And it might be helpful to include some of those maps for our review so we have a clearer understanding of what we're actually revising or what's being revised. And in the future, where the ordinance has to be revised, to give us a highlighted version from old to new. Find out if we are at the most restrictive standards, and to address the issue, I'm trying to find a shorthand way basically to say how much freeboard we have as far as I'm concerned.
Well, it's really the definition of the design standard, right?
In elevation terms.
In elevation terms.
In reference maybe to the base flood.
For elevation, base flood. Okay. I don't have anything else. Anything else?
Obviously, you have your own questions. You will fold into that.
Yeah.
As well. I don't think there's anything else. So, are we of the opinion that this is consistent with the master plan?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Unanimous, yes.
Okay. Then may I have your direction prepared appropriate right?
These two stuff, with as you've outlined, with confirmation that short of those questions being answered, we certainly find it to be consistent.
Okay.
All right.
We'll take those steps.
I know the application for Down to Earth has been moved to next month's meeting. I'll remind the board members that it is April 11th, so please remember to mark your calendar. I would like to open it up to the public.
I just want to make that loud. There's not going to be a re-advertisement of that. If you were going to be here for that application, in fact, you already have effective notice, there's not going to be a re-notice for that.
So it'll be April 11th. For anyone in the public here for the down-to-earth construction application for 414 9th Avenue, there will not be a re-notice. It will be heard at the April 11th, 2022 meeting. At this point, I'd like to open it up to the public for any comments. Please step forward, state your name, spell it, and provide your street address.
This is for that, not that.
No,
not
this is just general public.
Hello, all. Here, I'll take a seat, maybe.
There you go.
Right?
It's only me, right?
I know, I'm here for you. So, following up on my comment from the January meeting and subsequent to the executive session, in the January meeting, for those of you on the planning board that were not, Christopher Pitoni, 222 17th Avenue, Belmar.
Spell, please.
P-I-C-C-O-N-I.
Okay.
Sorry, I forgot that part.
That's all right.
So for those of you that weren't, may not have been privy to the executive session and or weren't on the board at the time, because I know some people just got, to kind of give a little background, on December 12th of 2005, there was a resolution adopted by the planning board allowing for the subdivision of block 161 into two lots. Block 161, lot 6, is a 60 by 100 located on 16th Avenue in an R4 zone. That resolution allowed the subdivision back in 2005 to be broken into two 30 by 100 lots. There were also a, which would be known as 161, 6.01, and 6.02, which with that resolution, there was a significant amount of stipulations that were required. Fast forward 15 years, the owner of that specific piece of land never acted on that resolution, let that resolution expire, and then fast forward almost 15 years to the day, actually. There was, the owner of that land, through their attorney, did file a deed, and the chairman and secretary of the planning board did falsely attest that that deed had met all the criteria of the resolution, even though that resolution had expired 13 years prior, right? So the million-dollar question is, how's this being handled? I've asked a couple times, and you know, it's pretty much fallen on deaf ears. I mean, how is it being?
I wouldn't necessarily say that.
Yeah.
I would say perhaps not moving at the pace you would like it to move.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, there is a time frame that goes along with that. I mean, you just can't create subdivisions without.
But there has been action taken, so I just want, and perhaps Doug, you could offer some insight. But I want to frame it out right that certainly this uncovered something that after 15 years, none of us were aware of, even though I think two of us, the two old guys sitting here, Rick and Jay, were certainly around in 2005. But Doug, if you could offer some insights on where we stand with that in terms of our communication with that applicant and their attorney.
And I thank you for your patience.
Yeah, no worries.
It's
interesting, I got a communication, not from you guys. There was a letter sent from Jerry Dosti, from borough attorney, which that I got CC'd on. It was a fluff piece. It was a cute letter. Don't get me wrong. Very cute.
I think you received an email also from Mr. Kirschenbaum.
I did. I was away, and then him and I played phone tag. Okay. And the last message I left him, the follow-up email, neither of those returned.
Okay. The email. Well.
No, I'm saying we played phone tag. I was away when he originally called me. So then we played phone tag a couple times. And then I left him a voicemail roughly 3 weeks ago. And then also followed up with another email just saying, hey, we've been playing phone tag, man. Like, when can we connect, right?
No,
and,
the email I'm referring to as to what the planning board was going to be doing with regard to this.
Yeah.
And the reason I know that is because I spoke to Mr. Kirschenbaum and advised him what the direction of the planning board had been. Mm-hmm. And pretty much the language of that email was something that I was directed to prepare by the planning board and did go out to counsel for the property owner, or to put it this way, to the individual who represents the entity that attempted to have the subdivision Well, I don't know what was actually happening there, but it was...
Hey, they took a shot and they won, right?
I would suggest to you that it was not your classic...
God bless them sometimes, yeah.
It was not something that was titled deed to perfect subdivision, which is what we usually see. But independent of that, and I'm going to get to the very bottom line, but I want to preface it, yeah, make a couple of remarks. The planning board is a board of limited jurisdiction. Basically, once we take action, after a period of time, we don't necessarily shepherd or do all the approvals or do all those things. It comes off of our desk, so to speak, then it goes to code enforcement or whatever enforcement it is. You're right. This was a particularly unusual situation. After reviewing this with the planning board, after seeing what the mayor and council, I'm assuming, directed their attorney to prepare a writing, I think the planning board directed me to take a step further. Mm-hmm. Again, two things are clear. Well, several things are clear. The property has been cleared. The property has been fenced. Mm-hmm. The issue is whether or not the subdivision still exists. The subdivision approvals were perfected. Mm-hmm. We have prepared a writing to the effect to the attorney that in the planning board's view, again, we have limited jurisdiction, mm-hmm. but in the planning board's view, they no longer have a subdivision.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. That's great.
Number one. Mm-hmm. Well, that's our opinion. Mm-hmm. That's their lawyer's opinion.
Yeah.
Okay? But that's me. Number two.
It's action now, which is...
Well, number two, the second step that we took, based upon the planning board's direction, was to say, and any variance relief that you had in the planning board's view was not diligently prosecuted. And that's a fancy way of saying you lost it because you didn't build the structures within the time that borough ordinances say you're supposed to be doing that. Mm-hmm. We have an ordinance that basically says you will act upon or diligently prosecute the variance relief that you get, in a sense, by building the structures within a year, or you risk losing that variance relief, and you're sort of at square one again. And again, that's our opinion. Mm-hmm. We did not pass a formal resolution. We did not take whatever rights you may think you have. We just told you that if you have intention of proceeding with the subdivision, it is our strongest recommendation that you come back to the planning board to go under that subdivision approval. If for some reason you still think you have variance relief, we would again encourage you to come back before the board. I don't have the ability, nor does this planning board, to direct the non-issuance of something,
gotcha.
So to speak.
Understood, yeah.
But that letter has gone out, and if the board gives me permission, I can certainly CC that to this individual.
Okay, no problem.
It wasn't meant as a disregard. Mm-hmm. It was just an oversight on my part. I didn't CC you on it because it was done at the direction of the board. Yeah. I can certainly share that letter with you, and I'm relatively certain I've gotten your email.
You definitely
from where that went. And as I say, and I think you'll find that in large part, the email response that Mr. Kirshen gave you as to what was being done by the planning board, you can see it's largely mirrored in my letter. So again, if that wasn't clear.
I never received an email response from Ed.
I'll show it to you before we leave.
Okay, gotcha.
No.
I got a response that just said, you need just call me.
My understanding is that you received. If not, I'm not here to get into a dispute.
No, of course not. Of course, yeah, I'd love to see. I never saw.
I'll try to see if I can pull it up.
Yeah, yeah. No, I would love. Yeah, I would love to see because I never actually received a response from that. Yeah. And I would honestly, if I had received it, I wouldn't be sitting here today.
Yeah. Well, no. I will do two things. I will see if I can find that this evening for you, and mm-hmm. if I can find the letter, I'll send it over to you too. Yeah.
Because the last response I received from Ed was, just call me. Okay, cool. Okay. And that, which I did as soon as I got home from vacation.
Okay.
Which I
so let, let's do this. Let's pull it to make sure that Ed had in fact sent that to him.
Oh, I know he did because I spoke with him.
Okay. And then the second, certainly I would love for you to share our response with him as well, so you can see what actually we take.
Now, I'm concerned. Did the board see the response?
I did.
You did? Okay. All right. Well, I haven't lost my mind yet.
So was I on the email? Is my next question?
No.
The Ed email.
Was that? No. I had not written. I was asked. It sort of came in sort of a, Doug, here's what we want you to do.
Yeah.
Coming out of our, you know,
executive
receiving
session.
Direction. Got a phone call. What's going on? Mm-hmm. Pretty much had it in my head as to what I was writing. Pretty much, this is what we're doing. And I thought that was shared.
No, I never see that.
But
like I said in January, as long as something's being as long as something is being done and it's being addressed, that's the most important thing, right? We all make mistakes. It happens, right? It's not how you go down, it's how you get back up. And as long as it's being addressed, it's the most important.
And I will share with you what I shared with the board in my observation, right, is that this wouldn't have gone unnoticed. You would not have gotten, I would suggest to you, you would not have gotten a building permit for that.
Yeah.
And just right now, you've got a structure. If you want a building conforming structure, you don't need to come back.
Yeah.
Our sort of correspondence, again, because we have limited jurisdiction, is if you are the owner of the property, and I really don't know where the ownership is, because I know that the entity that garnered approvals is not the entity.
Was a different entity.
To perfect something?
So Signal Hill, and I actually looked into that. Signal Hill and the MF and VF, they were the same principal owners.
Well, again, and because we checked.
But it's a different entity.
We checked that Signal,
different entity, yeah.
That Signal Hill did not seem to perfect a subdivision. So we were, when we first looked at it, there were a couple of questions. How did it get from Signal Hill to who this is to what you're doing.
Yeah. I see.
So that wasn't necessarily readily apparent to us.
Gotcha.
But through some of our expertise on our board, we were pretty certain that something had not been filed by Signal Hill.
Yeah.
And we're comfortable in then saying, taking a position. But as I said, if that applicant or that owner of that property decides to build, they can.
Mm-hmm.
They just have to build a conforming structure, meet your setbacks and do those things. If they still want to have two lots, I think they have something more, and we've expressed that opinion to.
Excellent. That's awesome. That's great. That's excellent. If you wouldn't mind sending it to me, that'd be awesome.
See if we can share it.
Yeah, if it is.
Once we get off the
meeting, we'll get it.
They're dying.
Yeah.
I'll sit down and talk to you.
But thank you guys for addressing it. That's the most important part.
No, I apologize. I thought you were kept better informed.
I wouldn't be sitting. If I was, I wouldn't be sitting there. I would have never sent a follow-up email. I never would have.
It was concerning when I saw you sitting there. I thought, he certainly could not have had all his questions answered. So
no, and not one of them answered from when we discussed.
I will tell you that we took the matter very seriously, and I know that the mayor and council took one approach. We were a little firmer with our approach, mm-hmm. and went right after the council, let them know where we stand on this. So as Doug highlighted, we're obviously a body of limited jurisdiction, so there's only so much what we can do. But certainly, I think Doug and the board came up with a creative way to try to influence the path forward, and make it aware to anyone and everyone that we could, in the town at least, as to what's going on and our concerns with it. So a lot of this, we certainly spent time looking at saying, how did this happen, right? I think some of it was the handoff of legal entities, but some of it was, for some of these older properties, we've got to come up with a way of, certainly closing the loop, if you will, on these resolutions that essentially are dying on the vine.
Mm-hmm.
Many people come in and ask for extensions. It's not unusual, especially in COVID times.
Yeah, of course.
But there was no request for extensions. There was just no communication. You would have 15-year period.
Well,
you would have
done that
16 years. It's like
there had been one request for an extension, but that was the initial entity. But then even then, it did not get.
And that was in 2008. That was even past when
that was past.
It was
right.
Even at that point.
And you're right, it's every 2 years.
And I'll go on record saying I'm very pro-development. Very, very pro-development. And just, it has to be done the right way, right? There has to be a level of governance.
Whether you're pro-development or not,
yeah.
I think there's a procedure you have to follow.
Mm-hmm.
And there are rules, there regulations or at least requirements built into that resolution that they failed to comply with.
They throw up a buzzer beater and hey, it happened to go in, right?
Well, it was a little bit slippery, so that's, yeah, exactly. That bothers me a little more than anything else.
Exactly.
It was certainly, I think the owners of the property knew that there was something going on.
And so did the attorney that drafted it.
Yeah.
Because they actually referenced the 2005 resolution in the deed, which is dated 2021, which is wild. So yeah, I'm all good. Thank you so much for, first off, thank you all for addressing it, handling it, very creative way of addressing it. That makes everything all good, right?
Good, thank you.
All right, thanks guys.
Have a good night. Anyone else from the public? Seeing no one, I'll close the public portion. And I ask for a motion to close this evening's meeting.
I'll vote.
Thank you, Mr. Myers. A second. Thank you, Ms. West. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, officially closed. Thank you very much.